If that's the way you're going to do business, then you know you need to take that business on over here and keep it to yourself. And the Lord prompting me 6 months later to pick up a phone and call this guy, and I'm saying, Lord, why? I've already told him he can keep this place. You know, that's a little bit of the personal arrogance, right? I mean, like, don't be pushing me like that. And the Lord saying, because I have now prepared him to bring a blessing to Trinity.
Come on, Red.
And I'm kind of like Nehemiah here. When I sat down in front of him and say, this is the vision that the Lord has blessed me to share with you about what we would do with the property that you have here. I said, oh, by the way, why don't you donate half of it?
Come on, Red.
I mean, you know, you want 1.6 million? Give us 800,000.
Come on, Doc.
We'll give you 800,000. You give us 800,000. Close your mouth, dude. Now I'm kind of like Nehemiah. It's like, okay, you're going to let me go to Judah to rebuild the city? How about some lumber? Brother needs some lumber to rebuild the city. How about letters to get me through the land safely? Because, you know, between here and there is a little bit of distance, and folks don't like me going through the countryside. And oh, by the way, if you just would like, throw a little armed guard, you know, keep the brother safe. And give him a title when he gets there.
Come on, Red.
Yeah.
And so I just came by to tell you today that, you know, you need to just trust the Lord.
Yeah.
It might not look like it could happen. Yeah. You need to step out on what God's got to say. You probably don't need it. Don't give me part of my God, man. Oh, yeah. It's powerful like that.
Yes.
And he just blessed into his life, even as opposition wanted to rise up. It's always exceedingly abundant. He learned the principles. He was operating in the principles that we talked about that Jesus proclaimed, Old Testament leading up to what Jesus proclaimed, ask, and you just keep on asking. Not seek, and you just keep on seeking. Start moving your feet behind your vocal cords. Knock and you keep on knocking. You plant yourself right there in the promises of God. And you don't move until God tells you that it's time to move. When he opens up the door for you, stand at the door, and even if you're standing there 4 months like Nehemiah is, and that door doesn't seem to have been opened for you, you stand there because God says he's going to open up the door for you. And while you're standing on the door, he's preparing your heart for the door to open. And he's preparing what's behind the door for you to receive it. So keep knocking at the door. Verse 12 says, then I arose, definitely, so I came to Jerusalem and had been there for years. 12 says, then I arose in the night, I and a few men with me, and I told no one what God had put in my heart to do in Jerusalem. No beast was with me except the one I rode. I went out by night by the valley gate toward the dragon's well, to the dung gate, and inspected the walls of Jerusalem which were broken down, and its gates which had been destroyed by fire. I passed over to the fountain gate and to the king's pool, but there was no place for the beast that was under me to pass. So gradually I went up by the brook Kedron in the night and inspected the wall. Then I turned back and entered the city by the valley gate and so returned. And the magistrates knew not where I went or what I did, nor had I yet told the Jews, priests, nobles, officials, or the rest who did the work. Then I said to them, you see the bad situation we're in, how Jerusalem lays waste and its gates are burned with fire? Come, let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, that we may no longer be a disgrace. Then I told them of the hand of my God which was upon me for good, and also the words that the king had spoken to me. And they said, let us rise up and build. So I strengthened their hands with the good work. But when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the servant, the Ammonite, and Geshem the Arab heard of it, they laughed us to scorn. and despised us and said, what is this thing you are doing? Will you rebel against the king? And I answered them. The God of heaven will prosper us. Therefore, we, his servants, will arise and build. But you have no portion of right no more. First life lesson, God's answer to prayer is always perfectly timed, be patient and inspired. Second life lesson, God's plan, field, provision is always exceedingly abundant, be grateful and faithful. Final life lesson, God's wisdom and vision are always powerful and purpose-filled. Be obedient and steadfast. God's wisdom and vision are always powerful and purpose-filled. Be obedient and steadfast. He goes and does what God has directed him, guided him, supplied him, provided provision for him, gave him safety and honor and title back to his home country, not to serve himself, but to serve the living God and his people. He goes back and he takes a discreet approach. He doesn't want to bring about a lot of fanfare, so he does his analysis. This isn't about Nehemiah. Am I preaching this one?
Yes.
This isn't about riding on in, you know, with the trumpets blazing and big fanfare and big parades and talking about I've come in here to save the city. This is about God.
Yes.
Right.
And when it's about God, you don't have to seek the fame and fortune. Spotlights don't have to be. If God puts a spotlight on you, that's fine. But it's to his glory. Not
come on, real.
Yes.
Yeah. But I like the fact that he didn't come riding in there with some big trumpet blowing, announcing his coming from this Persian or Artaxerxes, this Persian king. And he's the big player on the block. He comes in and he does his analysis almost stealth. I need to come in and do the name work and do the background work and do the due diligence, if you will, on just how difficult this task may look to the human eye. And then once he's done the due diligence, then he rallies the troops. He has seen what God has sent him there to see. God has given him a vision on how he will begin to attack the challenge and the opportunity. And he doesn't need to bring the committee to the wall.
Come on.
We're not going to be sitting up here having a committee meeting.
Come on, Rip.
Talking about whether or not God's going to fund us taking care of the wall. We're not going to have a committee meeting talking about whether or not we're going to do ministry. Am I talking to someone? I'm going to feed you to the cameras. And so, when God directs it, you step out on faith. And follow it.
Yeah.
And you trust that even though the job, the opportunity might look impossible to the human eye, it is nothing to the all-powerful God.
Come on,
somebody ought to say amen right there.
Yeah.
And so as he does his analytical work and he does his preparatory work, and he begins to cast a vision to those who have been sitting, the same group that he's gotten the word from that are downtrodden and they're anxious and they're worried and they feel like they're discouraged and they're feeling like they're outcasts and there's no hope for them. The walls are down, the gates have been burned. Everybody's feeling bad about their situation. They're no longer free. Now, and then he comes to this very same group and he gives them a vision of how God has moved. He says, I wanted them, first of all, to understand that it is by God's favor and his grace and mercy and his blessing that I'm able to stand here before you today and talk about rebuilding. It's not my vision, it's God's vision that I've come to just stand before you with. So let's not rally around the man, let's rally around the God who sent the man. So in a powerful one or two sentence message, he tells them, let us rise up and build.